Well, good morning. I didn't put my name in this time. Well, my name is Mark. You see me on the core team yesterday. My tech is CRM. Today I'm going to do a talk about extending Auth Component using authenticate and authorize adapters. One point three authenticate component. If you want to change it to suit your needs, you had to hack the core component, or you had to copy it to your application and then change the code, or you could extend it and then you had to change all your codes because your class name was changed. So this auth wouldn't work in your application, so you had to go over all the application to update it to be something like Authsome, some plugin done. I think it's used by a lot of people. I never used it myself, but you had to rename everything to Authsome to be able to use it. And some other plugin that was available was SuperAuth. It was doing some row-based access control. Well, Auth Component didn't support that in 1.3. So you had to change your codes or override and hack the core to be able to do that. KPHP version 2 already changed a little bit of that just by being able to alias your components, helpers, classes to use the defined name, and you can just change it by setting it up. I have an example of that. Like this, you can set up Auth Component to use some class name in Muffin plugin, Awesome Auth, and it would use that component all over your application, just being able to use this auth user, whatever method you want to call on Auth Component. So that's already an improvement, but still you had to would have to override all things. The biggest change in Auth Component in version 2 is that you now can just create your own adapters for both authentication and authorization. So you don't have to touch the Auth Component itself. It just contains the logic you need for the application, but to make it suit your specific needs, you can just create adapters. You can define multiple adapters for your application, so it will just go through all of them until one just returns true, and then you're able to log in. If they're all returning false, you can't log in. So you can use multiple adapters as well. There are some core authenticate adapters included in core. We all know the form authenticate. We're using it by default. Just checks the request data and compares it to the database. And well, if it fits, it will log you in. And if it doesn't match, returns false and just send an error to the user. Basic authenticate is also included. It's in core. You can use it for HTTP basic auth. It will show you the pop-up screen for the username password for basic auth. Well, the form authenticate, most people are just using that one. Digest authenticate is also included using the HTTP digest protocol. That's all included, but quite often, that's another one being added in version 2.3, Blowfish Authenticate. I haven't even looked at the code, I just noticed it was there, so I just put it in last night. I haven't seen what it's doing really, but that's another core adapter that's available. Well, first, I'm going to do a little bit about authenticate adapters and what Auth component itself will be doing. This is taken from a GIST. I have often referred to this in the CakePHP support channel. I'm hanging there out quite some time. And well, Auth is for a lot of beginner users a little bit what's it doing, and this is what I wrote. With Auth component, without Auth component, all your pages are public. When you add the Auth component to your application, it will deny everything by default, even your home page. So often you have to allow display, or for your pages display action to open it up to the public. You can use the allow for index or view if you want to have it public. Open all non-admin actions. See example, we'll go there later. And Auth component set up with authorized objects. Then you can see the authenticate will let your application know who you are, who the user is logged in. And sometimes you want to have access rules for certain controllers or actions or even row-based access control. There are several authorized objects available to handle that part. You have, for instance, controller authorize. That's the most used. You define an isAuthorized function in your controller, app controller, or just a basic one in the app controller, and your users controller and post controller can override it, call parent, and even add some additional functionality to it. And it should just return false or true, and if it's true, you're allowed, and if it's false, you're not allowed to go to that specific action. I'll show an example of that as well later. One other common thing, is it readable even? Yeah, okay. If you have Auth allow on a certain action, it's public. So a common mistake is I have this action and I have some is authorized applied to that, and why doesn't it return false? Oh, because it's public, so it won't even go to the is authorized. If it's public, it just skips complete authentication, authorization. It doesn't even check that. So that's a common mistake. So why isn't it calling my is authorized? Well, it's because it's a public action. So you see some code there on the right. That's the examples that go with the GIST. I'll go into it a little bit later. You see the before filter. You can use that as well, just with Auth component without any controller authorize or any authorization. You can just do based on the request param prefix. If it's admin, you deny it, but if it's not admin, you can just say allow everything. So you have a public area and an admin area. That's the most basic setup. Well, the formatting is a little bit crazy, because yesterday I did a presentation in Google Docs and I couldn't even see my slides. So I had to copy it to some other application to do the talk. And it had some problems with my formatting, so all the spaces and tabs are gone. So I'm sorry for that. I'll just switch to GitHub where my code is, so it will be nice formatted and syntax highlighting. So well, first go into creating your own custom authenticate adapter. Often used is the is authorized method in app controller or your other controllers, and they tend to be quite long. I've seen some crazy stuff going on in the support channel. When you check the bins that people show, I have this code, and there's really big blocks of code. you can just move all that into your own adapter. You don't have to do it in the controller is authorized. It's just for some basic stuff, it's good. Checking the request prefix or something. But if you have some more complex logic for that, just put it in the adapter. It's really easy. This is something Carl and I made up yesterday after those guys went to bed. We created for Kerberos. They're using Kerberos, and they were asking me about how to use that in an adapter. So we built them an adapter. And after they went to bed, we created this one, Google Authenticate. Anybody knows what is Google Authenticator with a number code, a two-step authentication? Well, we took some code from GitHub that's creating and checking codes and secret codes. Basically, what it will do, you add an extra field to your users table, and it's called secret. And Google will generate a code based on the secret, and it should match the code that you will get in your phone application. We'll do a demo a little bit later to show what's going on. Well, basically the most important part about this authenticate adapter is you have to define the authenticate method, because it's in the, as you can see here, it's extending base authenticate. It has all basic stuff for doing the find user on the user table and that kind of things. But you have to define the authenticate method. You will get a cake request and a cake response, and you can get almost any information you need. You can get from those two. Basically, you can get it from request, all what you need. You can use the request to read headers. You can check request data. You can use it for several things. Well, this is basically doing the same thing as a regular form authenticate. I'll go up here a little bit. This is basically the same as the form authenticate. It just tries to find the user in the same way. If it doesn't find it, it just returns false. But if it does find the user, it does the second step. It will check the secret field in the users table. You will get it in the return of the find user. And using the Google Authenticator class that we found on GitHub, we get a code and we compare it to the code in the request data that was sent together with a username and password in the login form. I have an example for that. All right, that's the place where we found it. So you should have a look at it. It's really easy. You just plug it in. I have it on my plugin, Authenticate plugin on GitHub, and just put it in Ellipse, two classes, and just call the new Google Authenticator, and you can use it, get code, and that's it. That's just one part, because also in your user's profile page, you have to generate a QR code based on a secret, and the user can scan it on his application on the mobile phone, so it will be connected to your application secret code. That is the link to my plugin. It has several kinds of authenticate adapters, and I have another one for authorized adapters. This is what the application looks like on your mobile phone. You have an email that you use for some website to log in. It's used for Gmail itself as well. You can set the two-step authentication. It will generate a random number. It will be only valid for like 20-30 seconds, and then it will just generate a new one. Just very short period of time, you can use that code to log in. Of course, you have to set up the controller. As you can see here, now I'm using two separate authenticate adapters. First, just the form, but I added the user scope, user secret is null. If I don't have a secret in the users table, then you can use form. Otherwise, it will go to the second one. A user has to enable this functionality in his user's profile or something. You can force it on your users, maybe, so you can only use the Google Authenticate because it will just use your form login with the extra field. Well, can do a demo now or just a little bit later? Oh, did I remove the login? Did you see that? No. Well, there was a picture of the login form with an extra field, so nothing special about that. Yeah, let's go to a little demo, if it will work. It's not. This is Infinitas. This is a content management framework kind of thing. It's a CMS plus, because basically it's nothing, just a bunch of code that very reusable within the several applications you need, publishable or create a modified fields. It all does all crazy stuff. That's just in the core. You can check it out sometimes. Infinitas, it has some really nice stuff in there. Carl's working on that, and I sometimes help him with it. This is his website. I have a username and a password. And now I need a code. I don't have the application on my phone, but Carl does. So, Carl, can you give me a number? What's on your phone? Okay.
Okay, ready?
I am.
521.
521.
319.
319. And I'm logged in. Now I didn't show you that it won't log in without it. If I log out again and try to log in with just username and password without the code, because I have enabled it in my users profile for this user, I am forced to use it. Other users that don't have this enabled can just log in with the two fields. And now it will just not log. Yeah. Doesn't do anything, won't log me in. So we just created that last night. I have Authenticate plugin is here. I can show you some other examples. I have Cookie Authenticate. It will just read from the cookie and try to log you in, the Remember Me cookie. I have not used it myself because I never used that. Some guy from CakeFest last year showed me some code. He was using a 1.3 application for reading the cookie. As I said, well, you can do that easily in a adapter. So I wrote his adapter for him, and he's now using it. I can show you what it looks like. Well, you create the adapters on the controller component, and then there's a subdirectory auth. There's a location where you can put the authenticate and the authorized adapters. So here's the Google Authenticate we just created last night. I didn't update all the doc blocks because it's just basically a copy of the form. So that's not completely secret. It just checks the fields here. It's a protected function. It checks the fields if they're all present. If one of them isn't missing, it will return false always. And here, well, this is the code I just showed you, just now a little bit better formatted. You can see the on the bottom again what we're doing. It's returning the user, or it's returning false based on the three values you have entered in your login form. Well, you have the cookie authenticate. We'll just read. Here's again the authenticate defined, and basically that's all it needs, this particular one. As you can see, it reads from the cookie. You can get a collection of all components that were used on this controller. So you can read, use cookie, you can even read the user model, the model class, or for the controller that you're using. You can get a get controller on the collection, so you can get some extra functionality from the controller or properties. I can show you a multi-column. That's one, another one I created. The collection is the component object collection. We're using in Cake 2 all kind of collections for behaviors components. Collection is the component collection. You can do a get controller on it, and it will get you the controller that is used for that collection. You can look it up in the API. Yeah, you can look it up in the API on the component collection class, and that is get controller, and it will get you a controller instance you can use within your authenticate adapters. I think I have maybe an example of that later on. What's this one? Well, this is an example of the multi-column. It's allowing you to use a username or email and a password. So it can either one, like GitHub does, you can just enter your username or your password, username or your email in the username field and your password, and it will check either one. Basically, we're just changing here the conditions for the find. And this one extends form authenticate, so it did not define the authenticate method here because it's already defined in the form authenticate. I just changed the find user section to do or on the username or email field in the conditions. Token authenticate, I created that for reading from the header or the URL for APIs. It will just read the request header. I'm doing on time. Oh, just 5 minutes. Okay. I'll speed up a little bit. I'll go back to the presentation, see what more we had. Well, authorize. You have in core controller authorized, I just talked about it. You just define the is authorized method on your app controller or specific controllers, and you have your logic there. You have actions authorized class. It will use a ACL component. ACL is quite often not a solution to your problem. It will be just another problem for you. Although the ACL component is configurable to use the database or the PHP file, ini file, to read from there, and that's quite often a better solution, just creating a PHP file, config file, with just some, you can read it in the book section. Oh, I'm not sure it has been added yet. Actions authorized, basically, if you would use a database, you would have errors and an echoes table. All your controller actions are defined there, and your users get an arrow, access request object. And the ACL component will do a check on the action you're requesting on a specific controller and compare it with the user in the permissions table and see if you have some permissions. But you can do that based off on a PHP file or ini file as well. And we have CRUD, it's also using ACL component. This one really needs a database backend. And quite often it's really overkill for your application. You better just off creating your own authorized adapter for it. We'll go into the controller authorize. What do we have here? Well, that piece of code again. Well, did I not put the other piece in? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I had put in something else. Well, the is authorized, you can just do some basic stuff and compare user. You get the user variable passed to your method, so you can just read from there if there's a role inside of it. User role, you can use that, so you don't have to do this auth user within your method, you can just use this one. Well, you can do some more things, checking if you have a moderator role, for instance, and you can check if it's index or view, then moderators are allowed, and delete they are not allowed, but just edit they are allowed as well, and just build up the roles and return false true based on whatever you like. But I would not recommend using this for more complex logic. Just build your own adapter. It's really easy. You can use it in other application as well if you put it in a plugin. More GitHub. Yeah, I will just show the something on GitHub. Oh, not yet. Here's the authorize plugin I made. It contains just two adapters at the moment. One is auth component adapter, the top one. The bottom one is an ACL component adapter. That one also uses the adapter style. It uses the PHP ACL adapter to read from PHP file. It can read with DB ACL from the database, and I extended that one for A2BM, has and belongs to many, because user belongs to group works with CakePHP. User has and belongs to many groups, doesn't work, it's not supported, so I created this one for the ACL component adapter. ACL authorized, what it will do is row-based ACL. It's very complex rules, quite often you don't need it, but well, just it was fun for me to create it. Just I don't use it as well. I think Krugo 1.5 is using it. Anybody using Krugo? CMS?
I haven't heard that much of the ACL because I just normally use it authorized.
Don't touch ACL. You don't need it. Now, if you come ever to the CakePHP support channel and you start about ACL, everybody will yell at you, don't use it. Yeah, but I have a user role. You don't need ACL, especially you don't need database-backed ACL just for roles, or there's plenty other ways to do just role-based permissions, and that's what is used for most applications. If you really have to complex permissions, then you can use it, of course, but for 90% of the cases it's overkill. It will just slow down your application, especially if you have a lot of users, big tables, create rows in arrows, echoes, big queries. It will just slow your application down. And it's very complex. If it doesn't work, you have to look up all the tables and, oh, I'm missing some record. It's very hard to find out if it's broken. It's very complex complex stuff. I can show you this. Maybe. Do I have time? Oh, I don't. You want to go or see the authorize? Oh, you can walk out. I just keep talking. It's coffee break, so I have 30 minutes extra. I'm not offended if you now walk out. This is the ACL authorize. Please don't use it, but just to show. It works. It's proven. It has, I don't know. Yeah, it has test, I think. Do we have test on this one? No, only authenticate has test. This one doesn't. So, don't use it. It doesn't have test. On the authorize adapters, you have to create a function authorize. You will get the user and the request. And based on that information, you can do exactly the same thing as you would in your app controller is authorized function. Because from the request, you can get the controller. Sorry, not from the request. From the collection, you can do get controller. So you have the controller, you have the request. So all the information you need, you can take out of this one. Basically, what this is doing, well, it checks for action map, because for row based, if you have your CRUD methods in your controller, they're all mapped. But if you have some listing action, you have to map it to read or create, or well, listing would be a read. So you have to map that to the. Maybe I can show it. Here's, yeah, this is some default mapping. It will create all those prefix, index, and it will map it to read. But if you have your own actions and you call that, it will throw an error at you, because you have to define an action map within your controller. You can look it up in the documentation. Oh, you don't have to, but you're not going to use this. But this part is important for the authorized adapter. Basically, what this is doing, it's getting the past param. So if you do users view one, it will get the number one, and it will get the echo from the echoes table based off that value, and it will do a ACL component check, user echo, and the action you're trying to do on it. It's CRUD based, so it's it will map the action, listing action, to a read. So am I allowed to do a read on the user view one? So it will check a specific user access on a specific user's profile, for instance. So it's really row based, one to one, and it's very complex. You often, quite often, don't need that granular complex authentication. Oh, well, there's the get echo. As you can see here, I've stored the controller earlier, and I can read the default model class from it. So you should use Cake's conventions, of course, with this, because the model class is usually the first one. If you have an uses array in your controller, always make sure the default model name is the first one. So you can order alphabetically. I've seen that on CandyCane earlier, and it was some profile controller, and it had a big array of models. Make sure the profile model is the first one, because that will use it as the default model class for your controller. Well, time's up. More GitHub, we just done that. Maybe there's some more questions. No? You all fell asleep? Then it's time for coffee. Thank you.